The idea of my talk has changed slightly. It's more of constraining the amount of turbulence in ICM through simulations and observations. So let's start right away. So what is the intracluster region?
Can you switch on for a test?
So the image that you see to the left is that of the galaxy cluster. In the center, you have the brightest cluster galaxy. So this is the central galaxy and all these are other tiny galaxies. This is when you are looking at it in the visible wavelength. Okay, this gives you an estimate of the size of this thing. But when you look at this in X-ray, you will find that it looks entirely different. And this is basically the intracluster region. This is the gas that exists between galaxies in a cluster of galaxies. So since this gas emits an X-ray, its temperature is around 10^7 Kelvin and its density is around 0.1 particles per cc. So it is very less than, but it is very hot. And the emission function can be modeled as a function of the particle density and the cooling function, which is square velocity. It is dominated by very strong emission. Now, what happens is, imagine you have a stratified medium. So you have the brightest cluster galaxy in the center, as you saw in that figure. Now, you have denser gas towards the center and less dense gas, hotter gas outside. Due to this nature of the cooling function, that it varies as n square, your inner gas will cool down much more faster than the outer gas. So the outer gas will lose pressure support and it will try to fall inward. So this gives rise to a cooling flow problem. So what happens is the inner regions will cool much more faster and they will clump in, and then you will have hotter outer gas coming in. Once this gas starts cooling down, it can go down to very smallest scales such that you can satisfy the genes criteria for star formation. From the amount of gas that's cooling down, you can calculate how much of it will go on to form stars, and you can have a predicted star formation rate when the ICM gas only cools. However, you also observe the star formation rates, and you find that it is at least 10 to 100 times lower as compared to the predicted star formation rate from only cooling. So what's the catch here? The basic catch is the ICM gas is not just cooling, it's also getting heated up. Now this is a multi-wavelength image. The red one is in radio, the blue is in X-ray, and the white ones are invisible. So you can see that these are AGN jets. So the central supermassive black hole, when this cold clumps of matter fall onto it, it injects AGN jets on both sides. And these, if you estimate the total jet power and you compare it with X-ray luminosity, you will find that you almost have thermal balance. That's what arrests this cooling flow, and so you have much lesser star formation rate. But what is unknown is how AGN jets feed energy to the ICM, and our goal is to see how much turbulence can be there. Now this is the Perseus cluster. This is a surface brightness image. Surface brightness in astrophysics, when you're looking at an image, you basically see it in 2D. So whatever matter is there, you integrate that along the line of sight and you get the surface brightness image. Now this, to obtain this image, what you do is at each radius you divide whatever surface brightness is there by the mean surface brightness and subtract 1 from it to get the surface brightness fluctuations, and you can see some structures here. So these structures are somewhat similar to some structures that you see in turbulence at much smaller scale. So the question is, are these features of turbulence, and if they are, then can we estimate turbulent velocities from this? Now as you already know, turbulence feeds energy into the system through turbulent dissipation. You inject energy at the larger scales, and energy cascades down to smaller scale and is dissipated at the viscous states. So, in order to model this gas, we take ideal fluid equations and we add source terms. So, this is the turbulent forcing term that we have. It is a random forcing field that we introduce. And this is the work done due to that force, the power due to that force. And then there are two terms, Q and L. Q is the thermal heating rate. we are not saying that the entire heating is due to turbulence, but there can be a fraction of heating due to turbulence. And so F dot V, Q, and L is a cooling constant. So these three together is your thermal balance. We have two sets of terms, one in which we study only turbulence without any heating or cooling. So that's just idea there, send out the thermal balance imposed. Then in the second set, we impose a thermal balance condition, and we'll come to this later on. Now, the numerical setup is we have a 3D Cartesian periodic box with, and we use this Pluto code for our simulations. And so we have two sets of terms, as I said, a domain size of 40 kVc, resolution of 256 cube. It was parallelized and we ran our simulations on Sarasota's computer. So once you set this up and you are in the turbulence only run, you will achieve a steady state after an eddy turnover time, which can vary depending on your forcing amplitude. So eddy turnover time can be given as the length scale of driving divided by the velocity at the driving scale. Now when you are doing when you are balancing heating with cooling, basically you have thermal forcing power plus thermal heating rate equated to radiative cooling rate. So this is the modified energy equation that we are using. I already showed this. Now we also for the cooling function we also impose a cutoff temperature for cooling, because we cannot resolve gas once it goes down to much lower scale. So we have a cutoff at around 10 to the power 6 Kelvin, whereas gas can cool up to 10 to the power 4 Kelvin. But what happens is the cooling function peaks up to 10 to the power 6 Kelvin. So whatever gas goes to 10 to the power 6 will go down to 10 to the power 4. So it doesn't cause much problems. Now, this is the definition of thermal heating rate. So thermal heating rate is uniform throughout the domain. So it's a constant which is determined by this. So you have the net F12 is a constant which denotes the fraction of turbulent heating. So the remaining fraction is 1 minus F12 into the net cooling rate divided by T will give the net thermal heating rate. So then we have to look at the density perturbations magnitude. So you plot the RMS density perturbations with respect to time and mega years. You have two steady states. This is with the thermal balances where we have both heating and cooling. So here you have one turbulent steady state, but after some time, a few hundred mega years, you start seeing a second state where you have multi-phase gas. So first you have very low density perturbations, but then you have multi-phase gas means one set at 10 to the power 6 Kelvin and another water phase because you have thermal balance. So if you look at the Mach number and temperature PDFs, you can see there's a hot phase which is subsonic and there's a cold phase which is supersonic. This is a sonic line. Then in the temperature PDF, you can see a peak at 10 to the power 6 Kelvin and there's another hot phase peak. So this is basically the two phases of gas. I would like to show a video right now. This shows the evolution of cold gas in our simulation. The blue regions are the cold gas regions with temperature below 1.2 into 10 to the power 6 Kelvin. So this is basically just a cold gas. You can see that it's a cold lump of gas which is turbulent on its surface. It's not the entire thing is turbulent, and the white ones are hot gas because we have set them to be completely transparent. So coming back to our question, what we aim to answer is whether these features are actually due to turbulence. So let's look at the surface brightness fluctuations, one with only turbulence runs without the thermal balance, one with heating balance in cooling. So if you look at this plot, this was done by us in the turbulence only run, you can see they all fit nicely to two straight lines. One got the Mach number squared line for subsonic runs and one the directly running with the RMS Mach number for supersonic or transonic regime. So once you know the surface brightness fluctuation, you can just go on to the x-axis and find what velocities are there. And from that you can, if this was, then you could have directly gone on to find the turbulent heating rate to rho V cube by L. But what actually happens is when you have heating balance in cooling, you have hot cold phases, things are not that simple, you have large fluctuations and this is the same outfits that I have drawn here. These are basically the same lines, but you see they don't follow the scripts, and for supersonic regime they are quite orthogonal. So now what we do is we plot a probability distribution function of surface brightness with respect to line of sight velocities. Hitomi is one observation which gave us the line of sight velocities to be around 165 km per second. So we find that when we have 10% turbulent forcing power, we are able to match Hitomi results exactly, which we get 160, whereas if we use 50%, 80%, the lines are much, they are much more broader, so they don't match. Whereas this red thing is almost an exact match to the dark green one. So concluding, I would say that the surface brightness Mach number relations are not universal as we thought, and this dependency on Mach number changes when we impose our global thermal balance. And turbulent heating is unlikely to be the only source. You can have cosmic heating and other stuff, and because it requires large Mach numbers to be consistent with observations. Then a combination of thermal and turbulent heating with 10% turbulent forcing power is a good match of observations. Thank you.